And as you're doing that, just want to remind you of a few things, let you know a few things that are happening. First off, today, we had originally scheduled today, I just want to make sure everybody hears it. We had an open house scheduled for today at Pastor and Dixie's house. That is going to be rescheduled. So just be keeping your ears and eyes open for a new date for that. And also want to make sure young adults that you are aware of, August 3rd, that's here in a couple weeks, I think, yeah. We're going to be having a young adult luncheon after church, and that's going to be at Pastor and Dixie's. So get that on your calendar now. Start spreading the word. I'm sure we'll have a Facebook page up this week for it to get the invite out, but make sure you're aware of that. So those are a couple things I wanted to make note of this morning.
Very good. Thanks, Joel. Good morning, everyone. Yeah, I just want to give an update. Dixie's father is at the point of death. He's just within hours. Undoubtedly, the family's gathered in through the night. And so my heart's there. I'm here, but I'm there. And so I appreciate your prayer and support. Had a great time of worship in the room. Discovered again that being in the home in this time beats the best hospital room in the world, let me tell you. And what a precious time. Our kids came and singing for him and to him, wonderful songs, and praying that God will touch some grandchildren that aren't where they need to be spiritually in their tender times. So appreciate your prayer. Dixie's and her mom are doing great, but that's really imminent. We were supposed to be away this week on vacation. We canceled that, so we'll be together. It just won't be at the lake skiing. It'll be in this gathering, but what a blessing it is to know where a loved one stands, right, in relationship with the Lord. So thanks again. I'm just trying to give a once-to-everybody update, so we'll let you know. Some have asked, his memorial is going to be in Akron in their home church where Dixie grew up in Stowe. And we'll get details out and all that, but thanks. Yeah, any pastor could not have a more loving congregation. And I don't think you could have a pastor that loves you more than I do. More. I didn't say I'm the best or the greatest, but nobody could love you more than I do. And that just goes without saying. You are deeply, dearly loved and deeply appreciated by all of us. So, thank you. We have a dedication. We just hardly ever do those, so we think we'll do one this morning. So I think Brian and Amy are here, and they're going to come and bring Isabella, Kate, and if there's any family members or friends who want to join them, and I'll ask Gail to stand in today as well for Dixie with the rose and all, and then she'll do a prayer of blessing. So come right ahead, Brian and Amy, and does anybody know how Brian ever started coming to our church in this family? Does anybody know the story? He was one of the people who put this building together in the electrical side and just had a really good connection there. And over the months, here you are, years later, right? So, very good. Hi, everyone. Just gather around real close, both sides. Parents, get real close to mom and dad. And just you can go around the ark, both sides. Just gather in, okay? Yeah, spill right down in here, too. Get close, okay? Spill right in here. It's so hard to get adults to line up, I'm telling you. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Make sure everybody sees. Hello, young lady. How are you? She's raring to go. Yeah. I'm glad my parents didn't put a head thing like that on me. What's it called? Headband. Okay. But it fits. Another proud grandma showed me her little baby with a headband like that. Don't make them too tight. Might damage them. Well, it's a privilege. I told Lisa, who just had a new grandbaby in their life and family this week, I said, that'll immediately make how you look at dedications totally different, no matter how many. And I know some of you think again, but it's a precious time. And I just jotted down some things I want to share today. First of all, mom and dad, you know, isn't it incredible that however many children the Lord gives you, you always have room for another? And the deep love that you have for her, let's say today, is off the charts, indescribable, isn't it? Incredible bonding experience. And who can find the words to describe it? But I want to remind you again today that I know what year it is, but I still believe that parents are huge in kids' lives. Number one, you have the most influence on Isabella of anybody. You do. you have more time with Isabella than anybody else is going to have. And the third thing is, you have more love. And that'll never change. That'll never change. And by the way, I'll extend that to grandparents and family members too. I love this quote I haven't used for a while, but I think it was James Baldwin. I'll give credit to him. He said something. I've changed a bit, but the gist of it is, children have never been real good at listening to their parents, but they have never failed to imitate them. I like that. And so as we consider Isabella, the precious gift that she is, I just want to remind you that this is a glimpse of the love of God. God loves Isabella even more than you do. And he loves you so much that he's entrusted you with her as a precious gift. And he has given the incredible gift of you to Isabella. She doesn't know it yet, but what a blessing you are to her. Got that? We believe that, don't we? It's not just the children that are the blessing. The parents are a blessing, and the family too. And so the word says, attention, Brian and Amy. Well, I put your name in there. That's how I read it. God, our God, God, the one and only. Love God, your God, with your whole heart. Love him with all that's in you, and love him with all you've got. That's the best thing you can do for Isabella as parents. That's what leaves a legacy. I was honored to do a funeral for a graveside memorial for one of my neighbors last week on Saturday, a week ago. And I'm so glad they called me to do it. And something that I hadn't seen before when we went into the place of the viewing, they had a memorial tapestry blanket with their grandmother's picture on it. And then all kinds of symbols and things that were about her life. It was about the things that were most important to her. And the prominent thing that jumped out at me was the biggest thing on that was her Bible. And that reminded me about leaving this legacy of the words that I quoted last week, I think, in my message. May all who come behind us find us faithful. We're talking about your influence over Isabella. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. And that's your greatest goal, isn't it, in your prayer, for her to know and love Jesus. Psalm 78:4 says, we're not keeping this message to ourselves. We're passing it along to the next generation, God's fame and fortune, the marvelous things that he has done. I've been thinking about this based upon a conversation Gail and I had with another couple preparing for dedication. And I want to remind you that as you face this huge responsibility and privilege, that in the book of John, we read that Jesus wants to give your daughter life to the fullest, right? Satan, on the other hand, wants to kill, steal, and destroy your daughter. That should raise up a fighting spirit in you. There is no way, no way. I'm going to do everything I can to fight for her spiritual health. And the best way you can do that is by the way you live and by the way you parent and by the way you pray for her. So train up Isabella in the way that she should go, and when she is old, she will not depart from it. What's it? The truth. But she's going to catch from your life far more than she's going to be taught from your life in a methodical way, day in, day out. Train her up in the way that she should go. This instruction is also a reminder that we're to raise her in the way that she should go. We don't raise our kids according to some manual all alike, because God created them differently. And he did that because he wants us to depend upon him and go to him for things that are specific just to her and her needs. But God loves her and he knows exactly what she needs. So depend upon him. Total dependence. And don't forget to keep circling her precious life with prayer. Keep praying, keep depending on him, and may this be your motto. As for me and my family, we will worship God. Amen? I'll take this little gal. She's full of them vigor and vitality today, isn't she? Hey, you. Hey. I love to smell their heads, especially when they're clean and everything. We always get the girls with these flowers. They can't take their eyes off of them. Well, Mom and Dad, hearing the challenge that I've given, that I believe with all my heart, and I am filled with optimism of God's grace and truth, that I know it's 2014. 14? Yeah. But there's hope. She doesn't have to fall away from the Lord and be rebellious, but she can early know Him. So, believing these things that I've shared, if before God, with His help, not on your own, but you will depend upon Him for guidance in her life, would you answer, "We will"? And family, would you declare your influence to use it in a godly way in her life? Every chance you get, your love, your time, your influence, if so, would you answer, "We will"? And church family, we're so thankful that we have lots of little ones all over the place, and you make a huge impact. I can think of kids, people in my life from churches that shape my life because they love God and they love me. If we'll use our influence in a positive way to show her Jesus, would you answer loudly, "We will"? Amen. And so now, Isabella Kate, I had that right? Yeah. Yeah. She's already into flowers, I tell you. It's my privilege as your pastor to dedicate you to God, the Almighty One who formed you in the secret place. And we do it in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Father, I thank you for this precious, precious gift, and for the gift also that the parents are to Isabella. I pray that she would early come to know you, that you would protect her physically and emotionally for sure in this world that we live in, but that more than anything, your blessing and power would be over her spiritual life, that she would grow to make a choice to choose you and love you and serve you all of her life, joyfully and expressively. We thank you for all the potential and promise that is wrapped up in this life. Only you know, but we want to do our best to facilitate it, to fertilize it in any way we can, so that she'll grow up to be the young lady that you've called her and destined her to be. I pray in Jesus' name. Gail, would you add a blessing, Amen. Please?
I like her baby praise. Can you hear it?
Yeah.
First, I want to see if you have a life verse that you'd like to share.
Get that mic real close, would you?
All right. The first one is more of... It reflects our desires for her, mm-hmm. kind of a prayer over her, and it's from Romans 15:13. We pray that God, the source of hope, will fill you completely with joy and peace because you trust in Him. Then you will overflow with confident hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. The second is a little passage from Psalms 119 that we just pray would become your prayer as you grow up. Teach me your decrees, O Lord. I will keep them to the end. Give me understanding, and I will obey your instructions. I will put them into practice with all my heart. Make me walk along the path of your commands, for that is where my happiness is found. Give me an eagerness for your laws rather than a love for money. Turn my eyes from worthless things and give me life through your word.
Amen. You know what? And I'm just instituting a new thing as of today. You give this to us, and we'll print it and frame it and give it back to you, okay? So you can hang that along with Gail's blessing. Sorry, those of you that have gone before, if you want a rededication, we'll do it.
Isabella, your name means consecrated to God. Mm. Wow. And Kate means pure. You're the happiest thing. And I have a verse also, Psalm 143:8. In the morning, let me hear about your faithful love, because I have put my trust in you. Show me the way I should live, because I pray to you. Father, we are thrilled by the gift of Isabella. May her life be set apart as something pure and beautiful before you. We do not know today what great things she will accomplish in this life. Perhaps she will invent something brilliant or lead a great cause. Perhaps she will compose an amazing musical work or become an attentive wife and nurturing mother. But beyond any of those great things, I pray that she will believe that you love her and trust you with all of her heart. Amen.
And all the people said, let's congratulate this wonderful couple and family. How about a little kissy? Yeah. Yeah. All right. Full of joy. Thanks for letting us do this. It's a privilege. Love you guys. Appreciate you so much. So nice to have you all here today. Thanks for letting us borrow you for this day. We appreciate it. Good morning. Welcome. Welcome. Hi, guys. Good morning to you. Thanks for being here. Good morning. Hi. Don't want to miss you back there. Good morning. Good morning. Hi. Good to have you. You can be seated, if you will. What key were you just in before you changed keys? Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship.
Worship His holy name.
Sing like Him.
Sing like never before.
Oh my soul.
Oh my soul.
We will
worship Your holy name.
Sing the chorus of Great is Thy Faithfulness, verse sing. Great
is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father.
There is no shadow.
There is no shadow of turning with Thee.
Thou changest not. Come on.
Thou changest not. Thy compassions, they fail not.
As Thou hast been. Together, Father, we thank You for this day, the gift of it. It's an incredible day filled with promise because of You, the promise maker and the promise keeper, in whom there is not a shadow of a chance of change. We can build our lives and live our lives. We can raise our kids, our grandkids, on the promise of Your character, Your nature, Your word. Your promises are true, and that gives us hope today. We are filled with hope and optimism because of You. We can be difference makers because we contain the love of God that is more powerful than any force in this world. We are Your containers. We are Your vehicles. You transport Your love and grace, Your truth and grace through us, and we want to be available to You. We just thank You for this gathering that's unique. Every Sunday that we gather, it's unique. People here, guests, never the same way twice. And You put Your fingerprint on this time, never to be repeated. And this is Your time, and we're Your people. So, Lord, have Your way. We always do our very best to prepare. You're in charge. We want the words of our mouth and the meditations of our heart to be acceptable in Your sight, oh, Lord. You are our strength and our Redeemer. You're our song. We love to worship You. We love to sing to You. We love to sing about You. We love to make Your praise glorious. We bless Your name. We adore You. We honor You. And may we do it not just with our lips, but with our whole heart today, with our lives, the context of our lives. May our lives through the week add up to what we profess on Sunday. May our possession and profession be one and the same, empowered by Your precious Holy Spirit. Every time we gather, there are always needs. And we come sometimes with heavy hearts and burdens, but we look to you because our help and our hope and our strength comes from you. And we are never disappointed. We are always stronger for standing in your presence and being attentive to you. So may by an act of our will, we engage, enter in, and worship you, returning your embrace, your loving embrace. There are precious people in this congregation that are going through physical times, and those things are listed and they're scrolled. Those needs and people, they're precious. It's not just needs, it's people. People that are battling for their lives in different stages, fighting cancer, treatments, and frustrations and disappointments. But Lord, you are in control. And I pray that even the word that you have today would quicken our hearts to stand in a place of absolute faith and trust, unshakable, convicted of who you are, convinced of who you are. But may your power and love move on all of these situations. May your healing grace and truth flow to hearts and lives, even during this time of worship, the different forms, in a moment singing worship. May your power and favor be released in life-altering ways. We love you and we love each other. And we thank you for the gift of this time gathering together. Make us sensitive to the needs of one another. May we be loving and caring, and may we walk through the crowd with eyes wide open, looking for a chance to encourage, to lift up, to speak a kind word, whatever the case may be. So, Lord, receive these praises now from our hearts and lives to your heart. May they truly touch your heart. May every act, as we in a little bit worship you by returning, may we do so faithfully with trust that putting you first has huge ramifications over our lives and those who in our family. We can never lose out by putting you first. We do that joyfully. So again, you are good, you are faithful, you are true, you are strong, and we honor you today. And I pray these things in the wonderful name of Jesus. And everybody said, all right. It'd be good if you can to start standing as we begin to singing portion of worship. You don't have to remain standing. If you get tired, if you're too tired or can't stand, that's fine, but feel free to stand or sit whenever you choose to do it. The communion corners are open, and you don't have to be a member of this church to receive communion. You have to be a member of the family of God to know him personally. But take advantage of that. You can serve yourself. You can stand, kneel. You can come individually in groups, fusion groups, families, pods, whatever, however you want to do it. But let's truly enter in. Let's engage. Let's not just wait to see how it is and if it's a song we like. Let's make the difference by our adoration and praise right here, right now. Here we go. Nate. Kathy, thank you.
Crossing out in the one, two. kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. Lord, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Love is deep, love is wide, and it covers us. Love is deep, love is strong, it's glorious. Love is sweet, love is wild, and it's waking hearts alive. Sing again, His love is deep. His love is deep, His love is wide, and it covers us. Love is deep, love is strong, it's glorious. Love is sweet. thinking over and over again of that scripture. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. And I feel like the Holy Spirit wants to restore some hope today. And I think there's some specific situations where you've been trying something, or there's been something that God's put on your heart to do, and you've been trying to make it happen, and you've been trying to see things through, and it's just not happening. And you're becoming very disheartened. You're becoming very even depressed. And I want to challenge you that tells you that you're putting too much hope in that thing. Whether God gave it to you or not, whether God put it in your heart or not, you've placed your hope in the wrong thing. Because our hope is in Him. Our trust is in Him alone. And regardless of what He's put on our heart, what He's called us to do, if any of that were never to come to fruition, if any of that were never to happen, we still hope in Him, we still trust in Him, and that's enough. So I just want to, I don't know what we're going to sing here now. We may stick with this for a little while, I'm not sure. But I just want to say, in the name of Jesus, hope restored. No matter what your situation is, no matter if it changes or not, hope restored, because your hope is in Him. And so take hold of that today. As we continue to sing, as we continue to worship, maybe you got to come down to the altar and deal with whatever that thing is. Maybe you got to lay it down and leave it at the foot of the cross and walk away. That's okay. That's part of it. You can't hold on to it very well when you got other stuff, even if it's good. So I just want to say, hope awaken, faith be restored, and may we see Jesus as our only eternal hope, security, and peace. Holy Spirit, come right now, shake off the chains, open eyes, open ears. May we see what You are doing. May we see that You love us and that that is enough. Come awaken our hearts. Come awaken our hearts. Come awaken our hearts, yes. Come awaken our hearts. Come awaken our hearts, yes. Come awaken our hearts. Come awaken our hearts, yes. Come awaken our hearts. Come awaken our hearts. Oh, 'cause hope is rising. Hope is this to be a command that we're giving to ourselves by the power of the Holy Spirit, that we're saying this to our own spirit, and we're saying this. Oh, we say, awake my soul and sing. Awake my soul and sing. Awake my soul and sing. You're awakening my heart to life. Oh, we sing. Awake my soul and sing. Awake my soul and sing. Awake my soul and sing. Your waking heart's delight. Sing it again, come on. Awake my soul and sing. Awake my soul and sing. Awake my soul. Rise up in me.
'cause nothing can tear us from the grip of His mighty love.
Say that again. Nothing can tear us from.
Nothing can tear us from.
It's where our hope lies today.
The grip. sing, oh, how he loves us all. Oh, how he loves us.
How he loves us all.
Think about his love. Think about his goodness. Think about his grace.
Think about his grace
that's brought us through.
For as high as the heavens above,
so great is
so great.
Come right ahead,
usher.
About that as we return, it's first, the first as we give. Sing one more time. Think about his love. Yes.
Think about his goodness.
Think about his grace.
Think about his grace.
That's brought us through. All the way.
For as high as the heavens above.
So great.
So great is the measure of our Father's love.
So great. So
great is the measure of our Father's love.
So great, so
great is the measure of our Father's love.
On and on his love it goes.
Great is the measure.
It shall forevermore
endure, the saints and angels.
Sing out, O love of God.
O love of God, how rich and pure, how measured.
Saints
and angels.
are the gathering of Jesus. And if we're going to make an impact on our world, then we have to be faith gatherings. Men and women of faith, that's what I want to talk to you about a little bit today. I want us to check the level of our faith and trust in Almighty God. If we're going to be founded and grounded on truth and grace, then we've got to be full of faith. The gatherings of Jesus, GOJs, we've got to be faith communities. Growing faith communities. I said it again. Growing faith communities. Is your faith growing? Faith in what? Trust in what? Is your faith growing? I mean right now. No matter where you are in life, I want you to think about that. I talked about faith being defined as an ever-growing confidence in, listen, who God is, in what God says, in what God does. That's what I'm talking about. A growing faith in who God is, what God says, and what God does. Doesn't that just about sum it up? This looks to me like complete trust in the person, the promises, and the activity of God. Let's call it God confidence. So if you're full of faith and trust today, your quotient of God confidence is going to be really high, like running over, spilling out on others no matter where you go. That's the difference maker. That's what he's calling us to live in. That's what impacts others' lives. Over the years, and I've been reflecting a great deal, as we had the couple that I had stand or wave last week with us for Sunday dinner last week, and we reminisced and talked about so many people and different times in our faith journey, I'm reminded that the strongest relationship with Christ that I've seen over the years have been those who have had the strongest God confidence, the strongest faith and trust in him. Not just words, but actions. It's no coincidence. No matter what life brings their way, their God confidence is grounded, it's unshakable, it's rock solid. How's yours? I'm telling you, I'm seeing the results over time. The results are in. No comparison. So I want to ask you another question. How do the lives of genuine, real faith people impact yours? Do you know any? Can you think of some who have been unshakable, unwavering through the years? How have their lives impacted you? Well, it may just be that if you're a person that's full of faith and trust, that you might be having a huge influence and impact on others far more than you know or realize. That's what God expects. That's what he calls us to. That's what a life in Christ is all about. A life of absolute, complete trust. Not just lip service, but we live it out. That catches the attention. That catches the eye. That catches the heart of a world that's watching. And they are. Over the years, I never cease to be amazed. Somebody says when you start saying phrases like over the years, that means you're getting older. I never cease to be amazed by the great people, faith in people like my parents, Dixie's parents, who have literally surrounded me all through the years of my life, over time. That was my world growing up. I mean, I was surrounded by people, warriors in faith and trust who never wavered. These kinds of balcony people, if you will, were what I thought was normal. I thought it was normal until I got in full-time vocational ministry. Then I began to doubt that. But over the years, I've reconsidered, and I'm saying that they are normal. God's normal, and that has nothing to do with the majority. It's God's way. Grace and truth people full of that, full of faith and trust. Faith people, balcony people, blazing the trails, leading us on, cheering us on. Do you have any of those? Are you those? Are you that person for anyone else? I mentioned it, but I'll say it again, that I've encountered a great lack of faith quite often since I've been in this particular profession many years now. It's true. And I found that faith and trust is decisive, it's distinctive, and it's pivotal. And as your faith and trust, please dial in today. I want you to take this away. As your faith and trust relationship in God is, so goes your relationship with Him right now. If it's not current, if they're at all kind of problem, it is right at this point. It is. I alluded to the passage before in Mark 6, 5 and 6 that Jesus Himself, it was written there that in a certain place, His hometown, the context there, He couldn't do many miracles except heal a few sick because of their lack of faith, their lack of God confidence. That's what He said. And so Jesus was amazed, and we could read on, and I have another passage of a scripture section that we'll get to if we have time today. But it says that Jesus was amazed by great faith, and He was amazed by the lack of it. Do you see that contrast there? Great faith was like a launching pad for seeing His heart and desire to become reality. But if that's true, then a lack of faith and trust in God is a powder keg that blew up what Jesus really desires to happen, not just then, but now. So I'm suggesting that faith and trust is a huge issue to Jesus today. It was and it is. When people put their faith into action, Jesus is impressed. Jesus is amazed. Have you amazed Him this week? Is that preposterous that we think we can amaze Jesus? I think it is. If we really step out in faith and trust in action, He's impressed with that. He's amazed by that. That's the example He called forth because He wanted the gathering to see what the pagan world, some guys there, faith that they had and trust that they demonstrated. He said, I haven't seen that kind of faith in all Israel. What does He say about us? What does He see in our lives? Great and growing faith is a definite sign of spiritual maturity. In the lives of faithful followers who go through extended periods of things like waiting and suffering and maybe imprisonment, maybe persecution or whatever, who receive an answer from God at times, no, not yet, or wait, or whatever, their trust is unshakable. It's not seasonal, like Ohio weather. Jesus seemed to have the idea that His followers flourished as their faith grew. Look at me. As our faith and trust goes, so goes our relationship with Him. He desires us all, every one of us, no matter where we are in our years or our spiritual maturity, to cultivate a growing faith. Is yours growing? If it's not growing, you're not normal. Did you hear that? Did you hear that? If your faith is not active and growing today, you are not God's normal. That is not what He has for you. That's what leads to all kinds of bondage and all kinds of chains and imprisonment because we're not walking in the faith with the trust that we claim we have. Doesn't work. I've got to say, in reflecting on my parents' lives, on my dad, mom, Norris as well, I would have to say that in these last years that I've seen their faith and love growing. I think that's the way it should be, don't you? I told the family last night, we were gathered, you know, a lot of youngsters there, some unmarried, some married, but I said, I have seen such a love story unfold before my very eyes between mom and dad and Norris. And I said, the fact that I know is two things. They love Jesus and they love each other more this last year than they ever have before in their lives. How many of you know that's normal? That's the way it should be. That's God's desire. That's His plan. This way and this way. All right. So I want you to think today, okay? I want you to use your imagination. Can you do that? I know it's hard for some of us. The great imaginers are over there and back there. And the rest of us are left. But I want you to do that. I want to throw out some scenarios for you as you think about this whole idea of where your faith and trust in God is really. And I want you to think about where you are in your spiritual journey as compared to that. So wherever we find ourselves on the journey of faith today, and there's all points in between in this room, I'm asking that we imagine. Okay, here's what I want you to imagine. I want you to imagine this. What would your life be like right now, if you had absolute confidence that God is real? Not here, but here and here. I mean, you lived it. Come on, are you with me? Not just a head knowledge. I wonder. That He is personal and that He walks beside you every day, promising never to leave you, but to see you all the way through. What would happen if your life would totally grab hold of that? Would it change? A lot of us are saying, well, Pastor, I really believe that. Really? Are you letting your weight down on that? Are you building your life on that? Are you raising your kids, your grandkids on that? Are you doing your marriage based upon this promise? That's where we get in the deep weeds. The faith and trust that we talk about doesn't match the quality of our lives. The profession exceeds the possession. Always a problem. This isn't bad news today. I just want you to think. All right. Could it be if we really could just press a button and say, I am a man, a woman who is full of that kind of God confidence and faith? Could it be that we would say things that I've heard in my life? There's really nothing I can do today to change this or that situation or circumstance. So you know what? I've decided I'm going to trust God to see me through because He said He will. I know that He will. Any takers on that one? Just imagine. I'm saying that's probably what people of faith and trust would say today. I've heard it by these lifers. Here's another one. I've got several. I don't know how in the world I'm going to resist this particular temptation or that one, but God, I have faith that You are bigger inside of me than anything that would come at me. This or any other temptation, I believe You will see me safely through it. I do not have to give in because I'm full of God confidence. I wonder if that would affect our week. How about these? Listen carefully, would you? Because it's all a part of the seasons of life when all heaven breaks loose in your life. Have any of you had all heaven break loose in your life before? It's good. There's good things. And God, when Your favor and power is all over me, I believe that You will help keep me moving forward with a level head. I will not be distracted in following You. This will go to my heart and not to my head. How's that? Did you catch that? The favor and blessing of God needs to go to your heart, not to your head. We're not all that. He's all that. And more. I think I'm going to get excited here before long. How about this one? Let's just call it passion. When it seems like all hell breaks loose in my life, this is testimony time. If you had absolute faith and trust in God, it could look like this and live like this. I'm going to keep right on trusting You, even when it seems like things are going from bad to worse. God knows what's going on. He's in charge. He has a plan. I want His will. I belong to Him. So I'll just keep taking the next steps, one step at a time, trusting all the way. God is creating another storm story, and I don't know the end of it, but I'm going to stand in faith and trust, believing that He's working to turn it all right side up. All heaven, all hell, it doesn't matter what the circumstance may be. God knew another posture. I believe with all my heart that God knows, so He knew this or that was going to happen. So I'll just keep trusting Him. I can't even control my next breath. I didn't earn it. I didn't deserve it. I didn't buy it. I can't control life events either. So I refuse to live with nervousness. I will not live in a spirit of fear. I am going to live full of God confidence. That's not an emotion. That's a choice. Emotion comes after that like a wake behind a boat. You get my drift? I thought about this message, and I thought about a passage that I often read at memorials, like I did a week ago Saturday at the graveside memorial. And I got thinking about the pastor's prayer phrase. You've heard me read it before from Psalm 23. And you talk about a God-confident passage. I think I just need to read it today, and maybe we just need to go home then. Or maybe I need to read it. We need to pray. Listen to what it says. I have beside it, I scribbled, read with expression and passion. Watch out. Here it comes. I'd had some of you read it, but I don't know if you'd read it in that way. Okay, we're talking about the level of our lives spiritually is determined by our confidence, God confidence, our faith and trust in Him. Are you getting that by now? That's not an emotion. That's a life choice that we live by, and it produces huge results. Wonderful results, godly results. Not just form, but powerful results. I want to read it. Pastor's paraphrase, Psalm 23. Since I know the shepherd, well, that says it right there, like know, knowledge, relationship, I do not need to fear anything. You might be fearing something, but you don't need to because the Bible says you don't. I do not fear poverty, for I shall not want. I do not fear loneliness, because He is right here with me and in me. I do not fear making mistakes, for He guides me in paths of righteousness. So I don't have to worry that temptation is going to sneak up and grab me and take me down, because He guides me in the right paths. Amen? I do not fear failure, fatigue, distress, or depression, for He restores my soul. I'm not saying those things aren't real. God's Word says that whatever, He restores you right in the middle of it according to your faith and confidence and trust in Him. I do not fear the future. That's good news. For goodness and mercy, His, are following me all the days of my life. I think that's about all the time, don't you? I do not even fear death, for I will live in God's house forever. That's why there was such peace in that room, Dad's room down in our basement last night, and there's peace today, because He's heaven ready. You've experienced that, and the lack of it. The difference is indescribable, is it not? Oh, this gets me every time. Listen to this. I'm talking about living in God confidence. Not in the past, the testimony of 40 years ago, but it's been upgraded, updated. Right now, it's relevant right here. God is beneath me in green pastures. That's like all heaven. He is beside me in still waters. We like that. He is with me in the valleys. Any testimonies out there? He is with me in the valleys. He is around me in the presence of my enemies. He is upon me, anointing my head with oil. He is before me, leading me in the right path. He is behind me with goodness and mercy. He is far beyond me in heaven, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. What more could I ever want? Is that enough? That's enough, because He's enough. We believe this with our minds, but are we living this passage? It'll make a difference the way we face this coming Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and days beyond it till next Sunday. Wow, maybe that's something we ought to start waking up and reading every morning, whatever paraphrase or translation you want. God's promises. In this chapter, we see who He is, what He says, and what He does. Amen? Powerful declaration of trust and faith. I totally believe and concur that we don't have to live in the grip of fear about our children or about our grandchildren. That's why we do dedications. It's a positive thing about our marriage or about our finances, because God's in control. We need to be responsible, but He's in control. We don't have to live in fear. What if we would change the energy, take away the energy we spend living in fear and turn it into a life-giving, forward moving, would that change things? Wow, just in this room alone. I know, we live in a cynical world, and people might accuse you, if you state some of these things I've read, they might accuse us of living in denial, that we're not living in the real world. I've heard it. They'll tell us to wake up and pay attention. How would you respond to that line of questioning or accusation? Could it be like this? If you totally, absolutely believed and had God confidence for everything and everything, not compartmentalized, well, he can do that, but he can't do this. I mean, you just believe him in all things. Yes, I am paying attention, sir, man. I do know the score. I believe that God is with me, he is in me, that he is for me, he is working in me and through me. He has complete and ever-growing, I have complete and ever-growing trust that in every situation, he's working in all things and through all things. Amen? My mother was, and her two sisters are, like what I've just been describing. I'm telling you the truth. I thought about doing a conference call today, trying to work that out, and have my two elderly aunts get on the line. One struggling with the ravages of Parkinson's, the other losing a husband of 70 years just recently. I'm telling you, I tried. Nothing could rattle their cage. Nothing could rattle their faith and trust in God. Nothing. And if I'd post them, they'd just quote scripture at me. I hated it when they did that. They had an answer for everything, or believed God did. Their faith and trust in God was never up for debate. No matter what happened, what questions arose, they would say something like this: oh, sweetie, oh, honey, it's okay. We just have to keep trusting the Lord in this situation. We have to pray and keep right on trusting. And they always did, and my life is so much richer because I saw it unfold. Talked to my Aunt Melva, who lost her precious husband, Uncle Frank, so close after 70 years of marriage, and they got married real young. And she said, oh, honey, I miss him horribly, but God's more than enough. He's seeing me through. He's helping me, and I'm okay. I'm hurting, I'm grieving, but I'm okay. Do we believe that's true? That's not denial, is it? That's the reality of God's grace and power. Others may ask, how could a loving God, have you had this happen? How could a loving God allow this to happen to you and to yours? How can you keep trusting a God like that? It seems like people love to engage in the ministry of doubting God on your behalf. Have you ever experienced that? Come on, be careful. If you don't doubt God, they'll try to doubt God for you and talk you into it. But we, as people of faith and trust, can respond in this way. I'm so sorry, I truly am, that what's going on in my life has shaken your faith in some way. But I'm honestly okay. I'm trusting God all the way. He will see me all the way home. Because I'm not living here forever. I'm passing through on my way to heaven. Are you hearing my heart today? I know we know this stuff. But what if we live like it's okay, that God's in control? And we're not going to let our life be wrecked or total by something that's temporal, that doesn't last forever. A lot of times the only eternal things out of temporal things is our attitude and the funk we get into because of it, instead of trusting him. These kind of responses that I've talk to you about cannot be explained for sure. It's beyond the mind's comprehension. But I'm telling you what, they cannot be explained away. No matter how difficult it is for people to comprehend and believe this kind of God confidence, I've got to tell you that it is terribly attractive when it's demonstrated in front of them. They can't explain it. It doesn't add up in their mind, but it has a powerful impact on them. Just being simply people of absolute God confidence, full of trust and faith in him. We believe he is who he is. We believe what he says. We believe what he does. And nobody can tell us any different. We've decided. Nobody can talk me into it. Nobody can talk me out of it. I've seen way too many lives lived and the outcome in the generations for me to ever change my mind about this. It's real. God wants to raise up our confidence today. Could I just say this? I have a purpose in that section which I called faith stretching. You know, that just imagine. Not, I mean, if you could, what would your life look like? Because the level of God confidence that I just described isn't a fairy tale. It's real, it's available, and it's possible. It's a place we all can live. I'll say furthermore, if you're not there, that's exactly where he wants to take you and me, to a place of overwhelmingly great confidence and trust in him that is unshakable. Yes. That's why he saved us. So we would be ever growing in our confidence and faith in him. Not in our knowledge about him alone, but in our relationship with him. That's what he wants for you and me. That's where he wants to take you and me. Both the Old and New Testaments tell story after story of men and women with great confidence. Would you agree? I mean, just flip to Hebrews 11 and look at those lives. And the Bible said that they all died not ever receiving the totality of their faith. And part of what they receive in the end going to be at the end of the story of mankind. That's what it says. Reread that chapter again. I want you to get this in these final minutes. Please hear me. All heaven was in earth when it was first created because Adam and Eve were so connected to God, full of God confidence. So what did Satan do? How did he attack them? How did he take them down? He got them to doubt God. He did. And because they caved, believing that God really didn't have their best interest at heart and all of that, because of circumstances, they began to doubt him. And separation happened, and sin entered the world. They bought the lie that God could not be trusted. How about you? I think there are some of us, several of us in this room, that have bought the lie that God cannot be trusted as well. Oh, we wouldn't say so because we want to do the right thing in church, but the way we live, we bought the lie. It's time for the truth to be exposed. They chose not to trust him, and the results were disastrous, as recorded in Genesis. Because they couldn't see it and understand it, they somehow thought that God was limiting them and he didn't have their best in his heart and mind. And so the big relational break, not just then, but always between God and man, was and is over the issue of trust. Are you hearing me? That's where we are. And God, ever since, has been pursuing us, filling his word with stories of his search for us. Not our search for him, but his search for us. He's pursuing us in order to establish, to restore that original faith and trust relationship. The relational break between God and man, every single time, comes down to the place of absolute faith and trust in him. If you've walked with the Lord for a number of years, your faith and trust in him ought to be way stronger today than it was 10 years ago, 20 years ago. Are you understanding that? And I mean, you've lived a lot longer. You've seen and experienced a lot more things. Those things don't need to shake our faith. If it rattles us, it'll shake it down so it's even more solid. You know what I'm saying? Like it's shaken down so more can come in. It's God's perfect will and plan for every single one of us today to bring us into a place of growing, of deepening, absolute faith, confidence, and trust in him. He wants us to experience that full life that he talks about in his word and a place of complete God confidence. So I'll ask you again, how would this confidence in God that I've tried to describe today, Psalm 23 kind of God confidence, how would that change the way you face and live today, this week? That's what enabled the psalmist to say, "This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I've decided. I've made up my mind. I'm going to face this day not full of doubt, but full of trust, full of God confidence. I'm going to trust him with the things I can't see. I'm going to trust him in the things I can't understand because I believe in who he is, what he says, and what he does." Any agreement out there in this house today? That's what I'm going to raise my kids on. That's what I'm going to look for a future spouse in. That's what I'm looking for, that unshakable God confidence. He wants to soak and saturate our lives with this confidence in who He is. God chose the people of Israel. I've been reading in the Old Testament. And He called them out in order to show the rest of the world what a relationship was like, what happens when God is trusted completely. That was His plan. That's why He launched them from Egypt. That's why He did all He did. Because that's what He desires, a relationship of trust. The New Testament is just a message full of love. We sang about it, where God's trying to bring us back to restore that trust relationship with Himself that was distorted, damaged, and lost. This can only come about, and it can only begin by personally placing our trust in Jesus Christ as Savior. That's what initiates and activates our trust in God. Did you catch that? Did you catch that? It's not in going to seminars and being full of self-help and all that. It's initiated by a personal relationship with Almighty God. We're not on our own. The Holy Spirit comes and He begins to indwell us, and He begins to, as we surrender, He begins to take possession of our life so that God can grow this faith relationship that is the difference maker. That's true, and I'm done. In marriage, in family relationships, listen. Trust dictates the level and strength of these connections. Hear me. Listen, don't settle for less, my friends. As trust goes, so goes a relationship. You show me a good family today, a solid marriage today, and I'll show you high levels of trust. Is that true? Where it's not there, people are consumed with jealousy that's ugly, and it's not a jealousy for, it's a jealousy of. Big difference, isn't there? I could talk about that. As trust goes, so goes relationships. And with God, relationship is the first thing. So He wants us to come to Him as we are, and He wants you to take the step and initiate and activate the faith and trust in Him and saying, it starts by humbling yourself and coming to me. But I want you to live a life that is founded in Psalm 23. I have that kind of life. That's what I have in heart and mind for you. Will you accept that? Will you come to a place by decision, not by your feelings alone, but that you're going to take Him at His word and you're going to step out in faith? I'm going to tell you, that's the sweet spot. That's the sweet spot that's real no matter what comes at you. Amen? When you have the joys, the heartaches, the disappointments, the ups and downs, that's the sweet spot. A place of absolute God confidence. Would you stand, please, if you can? I'm asking again how your God confidence level is. I jotted down this. That's the essence of this relationship. Listen, when God holds our trust, He holds our hearts. Did you hear that? When God holds our trusts, He holds our hearts. When God holds our trust, He holds our heart. So when we sing about hope, may that be a living reality. As we conclude today, this will be how we end, by singing. If there's something you need to pray about, if you need to cast your cares on Him, if you need to begin a relationship with Him that initiates and activates this hope, this God confidence, you can do that today. We'd love to pray with you. If there's something that you need to commit to Him, whatever, it's just a good thing to respond immediately when His Spirit prompts you and not get in the habit of just being here and truth hits us and we just kind of deflect it and think we'll deal with it later. Now's the time. Now's the time. Father, thank You for the truth of Your word, for Your incredible love and grace that makes it possible for us to live full of God confidence. May we live in the reality of Psalm 23. May it be relevant and real. Growing faith relationship with You, Jesus, I pray. Let's conclude with a song. Let's conclude with a song. The front's always open if God's Spirit has prompted you to pray. We'd love to pray with you. It's the most important thing that'll happen today.
I'm laying down my life, giving up control, never looking back.
I trust you.
I surrender all.
I don't always understand.
I'm living for your glory.
I trust you. You don't always answer my prayers the way I pray them, but I trust you. I do.
This passion in my heart.
Yes.
This stirring in my soul to see the nations bow for all the world to know. I'm living for your glory.
It's the testimony of our faith, our God confidence in our life. That's what impacts the world. Life doesn't go my way always, but you're on my side. I trust you.
For the sake of the world, I
will not live in fear. I will not be bound by fear. You're in control. I trust you. I'm trusting you alone.
For the sake of the world, burn like a fire in me.
Right in the middle of where you are, would you make that declaration? I trust who you are. I trust what you say. I trust what you do. I do.
This passion in my heart, this stirring in my soul, to see the nations bow for all the world to know. I'm living for your glory on the earth. For the sake of the world, burn like
go, let's go with that determination. The difference maker in the world is men and women like you and me that determine to live lives full of God confidence in front of anyone all the time. Amen? Let's go in that confidence. Let's impact the world, our families, our neighborhoods, our work environments. God's goodness and faithfulness.